guys.
Hello.
Welcome to the 15,000th edition to Where's My Latte?
1,000,000th edition.
1,000,000. This is chapter 20, the progressive era. And these are your co-hosts, Mrs. Collazo.
And Mrs. Knowles.
Healy.
Miss Healy.
God. There's already another Knowles here, Knowles.
I hate this so much.
All right. Here we go. All right. Oh my goodness. Look at that.
There's the dead one.
Guys, I put this on here just so special for you all. Look at that. Look at it.
Look at that dead horse. Look at those children just happily playing right next to it.
Yeah. And there's even one, the kid in the front, very front corner. He's pointing at the camera like, you stay away from a dead horse.
This is my dead horse. Go get your own.
We got to fix this. So guess who's going to fix it?
It's the progressive.
It's the progressive.
So we're talking about, we talked about how the Gilded Age kind of in the cities and the overcrowding and all that stuff, it created kind of a yucky situation.
A dead horse
dead situation. Dead horse situation, if you will.
Yeah.
So here's our superheroes ready to come in, swoop in and save it. We're going to fix all those things. Not all of them.
We're going to try.
We're going to fix some things. We're going to sure as heck give it our best effort. So here we go.
So there's different types of progressivism, and we're going to try to kind of bounce around on a few of these. One is anti-monopoly progressive. Basically, these are people who are like, you know, monopolies hurt everybody else, so
yeah.
Down with monopolies.
The biggest problem in this that society is facing is the fact that everything's stemming from these monopolies being the way that they are. So step number one of progressivism, change the way that monopolies operate, change mm-hmm. the way that businesses operate. And then we have social cohesion. This is the idea that like the welfare of a single person is dependent on the welfare of the society. Ms. Collazo is making
interpretive dancing her dialogue
over here. It's like a all for one. If we're gonna fix the state of one person, we're gonna fix it for society. Everyone deserves to have like clean water, a nice place to live, clean air, not horses.
Life
in the street.
Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Yeah.
Let's get some life up in
Let's
here.
Let's do it.
So yeah, that and then faith in knowledge, and this is essentially sort of like a movement back towards education,
yeah.
The social sciences. You can thank this period for AP psychology.
Yeah.
This is one of the AP art history because it's like social studies, sort of the humanities. Modernized government systems coming at you.
Oh, yeah. Some like the modern day, how our governments are run.
Yeah.
Municipal, state, and federal.
Absolutely. And your utilities. I know you can't wait to hear more. It's like being in Dwight's irrigation room. This is so good.
The themes are irrigation.
Irrigation. All right. So the muckrakers. The name muckraker is like I don't go in lakes because it's so gross. Hey, also, Ryan Mulhall is here.
Hey.
There he is. We're trying to get him to take part in this, but we'll see what happens. Hello. Okay. So,
yeah, it's nice. That's good.
That's good. Excellent. I just made a reference to Dwight's irrigation room. You'll appreciate that.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're all on the same page here.
So, the muckrakers, like, you don't go into lakes because they're horrible and disgusting, because when you put your foot down,
it's just,
you sink into that nastiness.
It's, yeah.
So, apparently, when you go in lakes, some students told me a few years ago, you're just supposed to jump into a lake. And I'm like, many issues. What if you jump on an alligator? What if you jump on a dead body? That's where my brain goes. Like, because
that's so weird.
It's so weird, but I went to Clemson University in the lake there.
Oh, did
like,
you?
Like Hartwell.
Blue Ribbon.
The Blue
Ribbon winners.
The champions of the
football.
Like Hartwell there, they would find like bodies in it like every like 2 weeks.
Oh, cool. Tight.
Yeah, so that's my only understanding of lakes. Anyways, the muck at the bottom of the lake, when you kind of scrape it up, it makes everything all nasty. It's actually Teddy Roosevelt who coined this phrase because he's like, you guys being all like raking up the muck of America, sit down and just enjoy yourself. Enjoy the ride. And there are a lot of people who said, I'm not going to enjoy this.
No.
You can't make me like this. Now, this slide originally only listed Ida Tarbell and Lincoln Steffens, but honestly,
so many muckrakers.
Yeah, so we have Upton Sinclair we added to this. You could throw a little Julius Chambers, Nellie Bly, Florence Kelly, Ray Baker.
Jacob Riis,
John Spargoo.
of course.
There's so many people.
How could you forget John Sparks?
Jane Addams. No, she's not really.
No, Jane Addams.
But she does write a little bit for McClure's, which is a big...
McClure's magazine.
Yeah, McClure's... it's like MC and then capital CLURE. It's a big, like, gotcha journalism.
Gotcha. You're in trouble now.
You're in trouble.
They're like, what they're doing is they're like writing exposés.
Yeah.
They're like, guess what? This is all trash, and I'm going to tell you about it. Standard Oil, trash. Cities, trash. Meatpacking industry,
garbage.
Straight trash.
Next.
Everyone was super grossed out by The Jungle. I have a lot of copies of The Jungle in my classroom if anyone wants to read it. Fun fact, reading the book made me gag in college.
So speaking
just the literature, it was so disgusting.
It is. We'll read a little bit in our class. I think chapter 13 talks a little bit about how we eat rats and people.
People would just straight up fall in.
Fall in. All right.
We've moved past that slide.
So social cohesion we talked about on the last slide. The idea of welfare of a single person is dependent on the welfare of society as a whole. And so we have another gospel thing happening here. Not gospel of wealth.
Nope.
And not social Darwinism, but social gospel.
Put it together. Not really.
Yeah. So this is now just that, yeah, we all need to take care of each other.
Yeah.
And it becomes part of Christian salvation during this period.
What would Jesus do?
What would Jesus do?
That's what I said.
He would help everybody out.
He would help everybody out. He would make sure everybody had clothes.
Had clean water.
Had clean water.
Had not dead horses.
Had not dead horses in the streets. Maybe playground so the kids aren't just hanging out with horse carcasses.
Yeah.
You know.
So we have the development of things like Salvation Army. The YMCA and YWCA, little known YWCA, the Young Men or Women's Christian Association. And it was basically a place for like, hey, kids, I know you're out of school and all, but you're probably going to go around and start like robbing people.
Right.
So come play basketball instead.
Yeah.
YMCA's, do they have basketball yet?
I don't think so. Peach basket.
Peach basket.
Biscuits.
But they were definitely encouraged to like play that hoop. Run with a hoop and a stick.
Yeah, then you just hit it.
That's what you do.
Or like the ball in the cup.
Yeah.
You know, wholesome games.
Social.
Because if you didn't go play games after school, you would probably just turn to crime.
Yeah.
Those were the only two options.
We know what you guys are doing.
Crime and school.
I'm like, do you work? No, I know what you're doing. I'm not playing hoop stick.
You're robbing people as hard.
Ryan's not amused.
He's got his headphones in. We're done here.
Now, a part of this social gospel movement of trying to help everybody out is Miss Jane Addams, an Ellen Gates star. You don't need her, but she does have two R's in her name, so I find it
just
fun.
Like Addams has two D's. It's the double consonant.
Ellen Gates star. It's a thing in the 1900s. We see the start of the Settlement House movement, and the Settlement House movement is that these women. You know what? I talked a lot. You talk.
Okay. It is. Immigrant women and children, right?
Helping them, yeah.
Helping them out. It's like getting them on their feet. Here's a skill. Here's mm-hmm. English. Here's a place to stay. Women and children. And we're just going to help you out. It's taking them in, helping them out, being nice. WWJD, what would Jesus do?
Yeah, it's very heavily Christian.
Yes. Teach them to read the Bible. A lot of college-educated single women involved in the Settlement House movement. And also, here's what helps spawn the practice of being a social worker.
Love it.
Yeah, loves that.
Yeah, and this journey really was focused on women and women and children, as Miss Healy said. That's really the big emphasis. But they did things for the entire community. She went into a really bad area of Chicago that had sort of used to be awesome and have mansions and then got kind of abandoned. Mm-hmm. And she bought up one of the whole house. And she just sort of revitalized it.
Forgot to say what the Settlement House was called.
And it's by no means the only one, but it's certainly the first and most famous. And she
started the movement.
Mm-hmm. And then she does stuff like, she'll have community events, like even stuff as simple as like picnics or academic lectures or mm-hmm. how to do finances, English classes, you name it. She was there to help people out.
She was all about bringing everybody up.
Yes.
Not just like, this is your place, mm-hmm. stay there. Like, let's all help each other out.
Let's do it.
Let's, hands in, team.
And I don't know if you all have noticed the headline on this. Story of Devil Baby told club women by Jane Addams. I feel like the grammar's a little off here. I'm not sure exactly what they mean, but the Devil Baby is a story which is so emblematic of this kind of fear or anxiety regarding immigrants during this period, particularly new immigrants. And the story goes, although there are many different versions of it, that there is an Italian woman who has like five children and gets pregnant again. Her husband is abusive to her, comes home every night, beats her, you know. And she prays to the Virgin Mary that she would rather have a devil than another child. She winds up leaving and going to Jane Addams' whole house. She eventually delivers a child who is born with cloven hooves, horns, and speaks in curses. The story is that they eventually took this devil child to a local church where when they opened up its wrappings to have it baptized, it was gone.
Dun, dun, dun.
Now, you may be saying to yourself, like, is that like a modern sort of like big thing? No, like it was in newspapers. Jane Addams used to complain about the number of people outside of her home, outside of Hull House, waiting to see this devil baby. And she's like, guys, there is no devil baby. But the reason it's so emblematic of this anti-immigrant period is that it's an Italian woman, new immigration. She's Catholic. Her husband's abusive. She has too many kids. Yeah. I mean, you name it. It's sort of wrapped up in this little story.
We were just looking for ways to be afraid of these new immigrants. I'm like, well, she's not praying to the Protestant God, clearly. She's praying to a different God. This is what happened to her baby. This is a typical Italian immigrant. No husband, all these kids. What are you doing here? We did conjure up a lot of stories and a lot of scapegoats to,
I like how that, like, an entire city believed it.
Yeah, everyone in Chicago was like, cool, let's see this baby.
I really want there to be, like, a devil baby of Jacksonville Beach. And, like, see everybody come out.
Like, hello, is this where the baby is?
She actually wrote an entire chapter about it in her memoirs about, like, people be crazy.
This devil baby does not exist, you guys.
Yeah. Although they say in the church today, you can still see the red eyes staring down at you. But I think it's like an emergency floodlight or something, to be real honest.
It's like the exit sign.
Exit here. It's it! Okay, women in reform. Key role of women in reform. Guys, who has time to sit around and talk about reform and make signs about reform and organize an entire movement about reform? Middle-class women!
Middle-class women. We're not doing anything else.
We got nothing else going on. Let's do it.
Crushing it.
Yeah.
Women were key. Middle-class women were key in reform. Lower-class women were working.
Working.
Upper-class women were like, who cares?
Yeah, look at my life.
I'm great. Why care about reform? And so it was really driven by this one group of just women, because the men were, middle-class men were working, mm-hmm. and lower-class men, and upper-class men were working.
Right.
So this is going to like kind of parlay itself into some like appropriate professions, quote unquote, for women, like the social work thing within the social house or settlement house, excuse me, but also teaching and nursing, because they all had like vague domestic, like helping things. But for the most part, they're really big in these reform causes.
Well, did you talk about technology?
Did I talk about technology?
How it affects housework.
Oh, yeah. They got nothing else to do because vacuum, or not vacuums, we don't have that yet. But
the Zumba is.
The Roomba.
The Zumba is an exercise. The Roomba's invented.
The Roomba's invented.
It doesn't have the same timing once you have to re-say it, but that's fine.
But there's a bunch of leisure time because of the technological advancements that we have.
It's great. Running water.
Running water.
Electricity.
Tight. Yeah. Light bulbs.
Yeah. Cool. So now you're just hanging out.
Yeah.
Eat bonbons all day. What better to do when you're eating your bonbon but start a revolution?
Start a revolution. Let's get it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You want to talk about Boston marriages? You got into that.
Yes, I do. So we have this like revamped new woman.
She's educated. She's bored. She doesn't like inequality.
She's educated. She's bored. but we have like a movement away from that home base of the woman. Like we don't need to be here anymore. Everything's outside of the home. And we, because we have that, we have a movement away from the traditional family that we have. Boston marriages is women living with women. Sometimes romantically, sometimes we're just palling around.
Yeah, but why? Why were they just palling around? Can
because
you tell me?
Because the men being in a marriage was bringing you down, was weighing you down.
Man.
That man was just dead weight, and if you wanted to live up to your full potential as a woman and be out in society and be a suffragette or own a settlement house, you can't be held back.
You can't be making French fries and hot dogs back here for the family.
We're just slanging French fries and hot dogs.
I need to be able to get out.
I need to go out and live my best life as a suffragette. As Jane Addams. Jane Addams was a famous person who lived on her own, was a single woman.
And Ellen Gates Starr.
Ellen Gates Starr. 2R Starr. Also, maybe they lived together. Who knows? National American Women's Suffrage Association. That's NAW.
Coming up, yeah.
One of the founders.
Alice Paul?
Not Alice Paul, Anna Howard Shaw.
That's right.
Frances Willard, Temperance Movement. All people who did not marry, did not live with husbands, because they were just going to be burdened.
Most American women in their early 20s these days.
Yeah. Live your life.
Live your life.
Live up to your potential. Do you.
And then go get married.
Right.
This seems like it's taken a turn. All right. So we also see the development of club women, which if you notice was actually on the last part, on the last slide with the headline, club women.
Club women. Go to the club.
Yeah, that's the first thing I think of. Like, these girls are going to the club. But it's not quite that. It's a way to get women to sort of be more empowered, move women into the public space. The General Federation of Women's Clubs, again, that's the General Federation of Women's Clubs, the GFWC, is one of these first organizations really encouraging women to sort of get out and let's do it. Let's reform stuff.
Yeah.
And they sort of morph into, like, lobbying groups.
They do. Some of them do become politically active, but a lot of the times it's just like we're getting out of the house and we're doing better for other people. If you've ever heard of the Junior League,
yeah,
that's a women's club. It's philanthropic, but it's also focused on the professional aspect, like getting more women out there working. Women's Christian Temperance Union is going to be one of the things that we talk about that is also a nice little club here.
Women's Trade Union League. That's where women working.
Yeah.
Largely factory. But yes. Good stuff.
There's a picture in your textbook, which you guys won't open, but when they would pick it and like strike, they'd wear these big old sashes that like covered up their whole body. And it's like justice for like the women sewing machine workers of the world or something.
We got to get on that. It's like a sandwich board.
Yeah, like a sandwich board, but just fabric.
Fabric.
Look at these lovely ladies. Colored Women's League of Washington.
I don't know why I left this in here, but there you go.
I like it. It was not just middle-class white women.
Correct.
There you go.
And it is Black History Month, so can't forget the ladies.
The ladies.
You may notice that was a reference to your period three when Abigail Adams said to Thomas Jefferson, remember the ladies.
Lest you forget the ladies.
Don't.
Speaking of sashes.
Speaking of sashes, there's a beaut there. And you may notice, like, what an odd color arrangement, white and gold and purple. But that is actually the suffragettes' color scheme.
Yes.
They used to sew everything in these colors.
That's our team colors, ladies.
It's also why women still wear white when it comes to voting and political show, which happened recently
at the State of the Union.
Yep. So very important color choices here. And there's reason they went back to British suffragettes and stuff. But for us, there you go.
Yeah.
So we start with NASA, NAWSA. We're just talking about the National American Women's Suffrage Association.
Yeah. Organized by Carrie Chapman Catt, CATT. And Anna Shaw, the Boston marriages gal, living on her own. Do you think, girl? Suffrage, meaning, we've already talked about suffrage, voting rights.
Yes.
We're trying to get that. We don't just have the NAWSA, we do have other groups as well.
Yeah, so this is National American Women's Suffrage Association, and we also have the National Women's Party. founded by Alice Paul.
Yeah, the National Women's Party for me is much more significant than NASA.
I would have to agree with you.
Yeah, so NASA goes way, way back. We're talking Elizabeth Cady Stanton, yeah. Susan B. Anthony, and it is a powerful, powerful group. But the NASA versus the NWPA, again, National Women's Party, with Alice Paul, mm-hmm. they are the ones who get stuff done, the NWP.
So they're a little bit more aggressive.
They are. They take their history from the British suffragettes, uh-huh. one woman of which committed suicide yes. publicly. They used to chain themselves to buildings and
get to the White House.
They destroyed a Titian. Oh, it's an artist from the Renaissance, but he painted a naked lady, and they were like, "Don't objectify her. You had no right to do that." Yes. And cut it all up. So they're really aggressive. They actually do hunger strikes. Mm-hmm. And Alice Paul actually spent a lot of time with them.
Yeah.
And she learned her ways through them. Yes. Now, the big difference that we need to emphasize, and I always look for little ways to remember it, is the National American Women's Suffrage Association. The S for me is going to stand for state. And that means that they are going state by state by mm-hmm. state to get women the right to vote. But the NWP is like, that takes too long.
Because voting truly is left up to the states.
Yes.
Per the Constitution, voting, the how and the why and what when is typically decided by the states. A lot of states are on the same page, and so they all do the same thing. Here's my gov class coming out for me. But in order to get widespread acceptance, and so you don't have the little niche markets that don't let people do whatever they want, you need an amendment.
Yeah.
You need large-scale federal legislation.
So that's what Alice Paul and the NWP did. They mm-hmm. started like these club organizations, these lobbying groups effectively. They started going every day. They mm-hmm. went to hearings. They protested the White House for a year, mm-hmm. sun up to sun down. They went on hunger strikes.
Alice Paul was checked into an insane asylum.
Iron-jawed Angels, if you haven't seen it, guys, got to check it out.
A classic. A
quick clip of it. So yeah, that's kind of what's happening at this time with those ladies.
Alice Paul is the one that defined feminism as the social, political, and economic equality of the sexes. That's our modern day feminism definition. And she also started the movement for the Equal Rights Amendment.
Yeah.
Which is prohibiting discrimination
based on
gender. The basis of sex.
Sex, yeah.
mm-hmm. Excuse me.
All right. So conservative arguments for suffrage that tends to lean more towards the idea that women being more politically active brings some of their value from the home life
yeah.
into the more public life, and that it may actually stop male aggression.
Yeah.
And that's particularly prevalent during World War I, that idea that everyone's women like, would balance it.
Everyone's all amped up and ready to fight, and women are mm-hmm. like, let's just step back a few.
Take a breather.
Yeah, let's take a breather. Let's all calm down.
But we eventually do get this passed. 19th Amendment in 1919.
19th Amendment. Mm-hmm. Easy to remember. You're welcome.
And that is the women's right to vote. Guys, no taxation without representation. I ain't paying taxes unless I get a say in my representation. Done.
Amen, sister.
Yeah, and it was largely seen as also, or at least Wilson accepted it as part of like a war measure. Like, yeah, you're helping with the war. I guess you should vote too.
Fine.
Can you also stop protesting? Okay.
Yes. Wilson was just like, oh my God, stop.
Every day you're here.
You're here always. They're like, we're not doing anything else.
Right. Exactly.
Middle class women.
So the Equal Rights Amendment, I saw at the State of the Union, green pens for reviving the ERA because it has not passed, ladies and gentlemen.
I had a student in my class the other day wearing a green pen when she came to class. Adore her. She's in my honors class.
There you go.
A gem.
One thing I do want to say about the 19th Amendment, though, is that when they do get this right to vote, mm-hmm. women don't. They largely don't go and vote,
right.
at least immediately. And a lot of that is because they're still coming overcoming stigmas that have to do with it as a more masculine sort of uh-huh. Kind of affiliation. So
it was
considered emasculating at this point just to not actually, as a male, be part of a political party.
Oh.
They saw you as wimpy.
If you weren't a part of a political party?
Yeah.
Okay. So the next thing we're going to do is reform city-state government.
Let's do it.
That's such an important part of progressivism that I think we often sort of ignore because we look at federal reform, things like women's right to vote, probably other stuff, kidding, with stuff like monopolies and whatnot. So, but there is, you know, we saw a lot of corruption in the last unit, which is really at the same time. I feel like there, we feel distinctly like this is an entirely different time period from the Gilded Age. And the truth is, it's really happening during and then kind of continuing after we start to see sort of, I guess, what we would define as
decline. We kind of talked about it last unit where there was like complaints. There was, like, the social Darwinists, there were the people at the top, there were the...
Cartoonist Thomas Nast.
What are we talking about? Robber barons. That's what I'm talking about.
Wow, okay.
And then there were... there were people that were, like, blatantly confronting that behavior.
Yeah.
They just weren't successful.
Right.
Here we are. Here's the success now.
And we saw that it wasn't just some federal issues, but we were also seeing... on state and city level, that municipal level, we need reform in a lot of ways because of the political machines, Boss Tweed and whatnot. So this is kind of a way to reform that, and this is a very aggressive title: The Assault on the Parties. Parties are going to be just fine. Don't even worry about it. Yeah. So new forms of governance. An interesting side note. The commission plan and city manager plan actually started because of Galveston, Texas. There was a major hurricane that wiped everything out, basically like leveled the place. And they had to really quickly find a way to start to recover. And so they came up with this plan where they basically are going to have a sort of a checks and balances internally in the government system for the city. And it bounce back. And then everybody else is like, wow, we should just do that like all the time.
We should keep this going.
Just keep doing it.
So was that the commission or the...
I think it was the city manager plan.
Yeah, that sounds...
No. Right. It was commission
plan.
It was because what they wanted to do... it is on the notes. I watched a History Channel thing on it one time. So what they basically wanted to do, since there was so much that they needed to fix after the hurricane, they said, okay, this guy's going to be in charge of police force, a police commissioner. This person's going to be in charge of education, the education commissioner. And so they sort of split it up by people that sort of already knew that sort of environment, and then they could quickly get it back up on its feet.
Like middle management, but for cities.
Yeah.
Okay.
The problem with the commission plan is that it's easily corrupted.
Government being corrupted?
Yeah, if you just take like a teacher, pick me please, and you're like, you're in charge of education, I'm going to be like, yeah, let's bribe me up.
Yeah, I'll take whatever bribes that you want to give me.
I'm down. Let's do it.
I feel like I would be corrupted easily.
Easily. I get it. I mean, I know my
absolute
limits.
Power corrupts absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, you got to know thyself. And so what they decided to do was to create the city manager plan, which basically is going to have somebody above the commissioners that's kind of like, stop taking bribes.
Yeah.
Give me some of your bribes.
They're all these people are going to be nonpartisan, right? No, just the commissions. City managers are elected, right?
They're elected.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Chris Traeger. If you watch Parks and Rec, Chris Traeger was this. Rob Lowe, he was the city manager. Love him. This is just a few ways that we are trying to disperse power and then also monitor that dispersed power so that even the dispersed power isn't corrupt. We had a lot of problems with cities. There was some issues, and so we really had to hit those hard. Tom Johnson, reason he's on here, is because one of the ways that we would really hoard power in cities was through the utilities, through water, gas, electricity, and so because they were privately owned, they would just like price gouge people and like
JA. Sorry, that's not JA is not exactly super private. So.
No, it's not because we've changed these things
Literally what we're discussing. But still, they charge too much money.
I know
it's for things like water and electric. And come on now. Well, it's called gas and water socialism, but that's really, the whole thing was like, you need water, you need heat in many cases, you need all these things.
Why are we paying for things that we like absolutely need to live?
You have to have.
So we don't die.
Yeah, like, and remember, part of our whole thing is that we have we have the right to life, right? Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Behind. You have the right to light. So gas and water socialism.
Yeah.
That made sense in my
bringing
brain.
Back to the, what was that type? What? Bringing it back to something. Social cohesion. Everybody needs to live.
Oh, yeah. That's right. First slide.
First slide. So, yeah. Tom Johnson was the person that suggested that. Cleveland mayor. Also wanted to publicize public transportation as well. Streetcars.
Yeah.
Street smarts. Streetcars.
Streetcars. Well, you know, and streetcars are important. It's kind of like maybe we think about it as our modern internet. Like you kind of It's how we keep connected. It's how we work. And for a large part, so lack of those opportunities is going to sort of depress
severely
the population.
Inhibit a large portion of the population.
Look at that, bringing it into the future.
Coming in on, look at you with the internet connection. I love this. Thanks. Okay, so that's cities, that's local municipal governments, and we also are going to have a lot of changes at the state level as well. My favorite things to talk about are the state level changes.
Okay, I'm going to let you go with this. I'm going to sip my latte.
Okay. I like your cup, by the way.
Thank you. That Lexi DeRosier's mom made this last year as a bribe accepted.
See, never pick her as the education commission.
Not allowed to be the education.
Look at my lack of bribes
here. It was a lovely holiday gift.
Oh,
I appreciate
it. Okay, so at the state level, we're going to have many, many reforms as well. This is going to focus on political participation and kind of picking that up. If we have power distributed to more people, broadening the franchise a little bit, not really. It's the same people voting. It's just more power.
Yeah. I mean, outside from like women as of 1920.
Well, yeah.
Who don't show up. Okay.
I'm sorry. All that work. So we're going to want to distribute the power because of the corruption in the government. We are giving them a lot of power, and this is a democracy, so let us open up. So a few things that we do, initiative and referendum, those are like putting issues and legislation directly on the ballot, getting people to vote directly on legislation. And that's only at the state level. Obviously, we don't like vote on federal legislation. That's like if you watch TV and you see ads around campaign time that's like vote yes on one or vote no on eight or whatever. I'm just making up numbers. Please don't at me because I don't know what those things are. Those are what we're talking about, initiative and referendum. The initiative, to keep them separate, this is allowing people to submit legislation, putting the initiative out there, and then referendum is the actions of we're going to vote on those actions. That's the referendum part. And then we have more legislation, or not legislation, more voting power, direct primary, and recall. We did not have direct voting for people in power at the state level a lot of the times. At the municipal level, we also didn't have direct election of United States senators. That's coming. Is that not 16 yet. Or 17?
16.
16. Good times.
Maybe not. I don't know.
It might be 17.
It might be 17. I feel like 16 is income tax.
I feel like it is income tax, yeah. Whoops, sorry guys.
Guys, it's early. We're just rolling with it. I don't even have notes now.
She's just sipping her latte.
Just thinking about progressives.
So direct primary, we're actually voting, and it's a popular vote. That's a direct primary. It's a popular election for...
Which is what we do today.
Yes.
That's why right now the Democrats, and it's only February, have like 300 people running for president.
A million people voting for president.
A million people. And basically what starts happening now is that people will kind of knock them off one by one in primary.
In primary season. As we start to realize we can't all... be president, they'll just kind of walk away.
God, that'd be so weird.
I know. What if we had like 85
like a collective entity of presidents? It's like a Congress of presidents. I feel like we're going Articles of Confederation when we get into that.
So. Yeah, that's a little sketch.
Step it back.
we've realized the fault in those systems.
That's how fast that took. All right.
And then
I love the recall.
Yes, and recall. We could take people out of office. If we're gonna keep speaking on Parks and Rec. Leslie Knope got recalled from office.
She was.
There's true. So many connections to Parks and Rec.
Oh my gosh, let's just watch that.
Yep, instead of listening to the rest of the lecture, just turn this off and watch all of Parks and Recreation.
So when we recall somebody, how do you start that process?
There's a lot of petitions
that
happen.
And under what circumstances would we recall someone?
Oh, if you don't like what they're doing in office. Okay. Corruption. If you're like, oh, they did something illegal.
Uh-huh.
You can't, recall, I call it in my honors classes like baby impeachment.
Yeah.
It's like baby impeachment. We can get them out if they did something illegal.
If they break the public trust.
Mm-hmm. If they're like all of a sudden like you're not doing what you said you were going to do for us. Then we can put an initiative out there to recall them from public office.
Has it ever happened?
To Leslie, no.
Also to the governor of California back in the day.
It happened a lot recently too.
It might have. I know that that's how Arnold Schwarzenegger got in office in California because the first governor had been recalled. But being recalled doesn't automatically mean that you can't still run. In fact, that guy turned around and ran.
Yeah.
But lost.
You just don't have that seat for the time being.
Yeah.
You can run again.
You can keep running.
Who would have the guts to be like, yeah, I just was voted out of office by all these people.
Do it again.
We're going to try this again.
I think the hope probably lies a little bit looking at the population of those voters. Like, the people who get all, like, angry and uppity. Uppity is not the right word, but you know what I mean.
Hoity-toity.
You feel the people who get super angry and frustrated and are very, very verbal also lose steam pretty quick and won't show up to vote against you later. So. Right.
They wasted all of their energy.
All
on
their
energy.
They had to take a nap.
They're like, oh, God.
I did it. No, you didn't.
No, we're not done. Still got things to do.
Yeah. So then we have Robert La Follette. I have previously wanted to call him Robert La Follette, but it's not. It's Robert La Follette.
He's from Wisconsin.
Yeah. Excuse him. Why? I sound like Miss Knowles.
You sound
today.
Like me.
So Robert La Follette is a governor of Wisconsin.
Governor.
And he is like, yo, you know what? If we've got like an education department, we should put Collazo in charge of it because she's a teacher and she knows her thing. Side note, also, again, don't do that. I accept bribes too openly and willingly. So instead, it's like instead of putting up like, I have to be careful about my choices here. Instead of putting somebody in charge of an education department for a state that, let's say, has interest in just being a politician, basically. I just want to stay in politics forever and ever, and I'll do whatever the governor wants me to do, even if I have no education background, even if I've never taught in a school, I've never administered anything in a school, I've never done anything in a school, I've gone to private school, and now I'm going to be over public schools, that sort of thing. He's like, that doesn't make any sense. The people who are going to be in charge of public education need to be employed within that area. Yeah. So basically it's taking specialized individuals in education or training and putting them in charge of that area of state government. Environment? Yeah. Get an environmentalist.
Get an environmentalist.
Get somebody who understands trees.
You know what's crazy is that this is a progressive idea. Getting people that know what they're talking about to run those things. That's some crazy, wild liberal idea.
That's true. I know, right?
Isn't that crazy?
And in reality, the reason La Follette is so interested in that is that he sees very clearly within his own government in Wisconsin, but also in the surrounding governments and federal, that people who don't have a vested interest in that area of their expertise are easily taken advantage of.
Yes.
They're easily swayed. And
because
so
they don't know.
They don't know. They don't know what they don't know.
They're looking for help.
Yeah.
And the people that they're looking towards for help are like, oh, yeah, just do it this way. And it's only going to benefit them.
Yeah. But you don't know any better because you're just a politician.
Because you don't know. Right. Yeah, you're just a politician.
But this idea, what we call the Wisconsin idea, that's actually the SFI, it's capitalized Wisconsin idea. Not only takes over Wisconsin and just amazing, but it even goes to the federal level.
Yeah. The laboratory of progressivism is what we call the state of Wisconsin.
Yeah.
And because La Follette was doing this, but he was doing a bunch of other stuff too.
Right. And he's going to be pulled more towards the federal government at one point. And even when we get to Teddy Roosevelt, we're going to see that happen.
Yeah.
he does a lot with it. We'll get to that.
We're going
to
open up some
Ballinger Pinchot affair.
I love the Ballinger Pinchot. Yeah.
Don't worry about that yet, kids. It's coming up.
Look at my little flowchart.
Oh, man. You got a thing for Taft. All right. So parties and interest groups, we do start to see, although, I mean, it's like a slight decline at this time at the parties. The reason being that we start seeing lobbyists who are not new, but they now have more power.
Right. We've always had people that are like, hey, we should do this with legislation.
It starts now like under grant or something.
Yeah, it's now. Way back. Yeah. Yeah, I think so. I wrote a big old, like, 20-page paper on political parties and, like, their declines and ebbs and flows and things like that. So that's my thing. But yeah, we've always had, like, people that go to the federal government and are like, here are all these people that are on this same page about this one political or individual interest, and it could be about the environment, it could be about money, it could be about education, very niche things too. But now we have dispersion, I guess, of political power, we're going to see a quick little rise in things like the interest groups where we have, like, more people that are like, we all care about this thing, so we should be doing this and not whatever you want, federal government.
Perfect.
Yeah, there you go. All right. Keeping it going. Oh. Labor, the Machine, and Reform, Triangle Shirtwaist Fire. Let's talk about this. We still have the labor movement. Samuel Gompers is still a guy. We're going to, because, I mean, how successful was the labor movement of period six? It kind of, we saw it just die out after a lot of unsuccessful strikes that were broken up. But we still have unions, and we still have issues that we're going to see, like the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire, or events that we're going to see like the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire cause big problems and spark some reform. So this Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire, a shirtwaist is just a shirt for ladies that you can tuck into your skirt, right?
Yeah. Nice. I'm texting people. I got friends.
Yeah. Sorry. She's super busy right now. So this fire killed a lot of working class women. It, in order to increase the productivity of the women in the textile factory, they'd lock all the doors. And they'd only let them out for, like, breaks for minutes at a time. And then they'd put them back in and lock. And then, like, a pile of scraps caught on fire. Yeah. Lit the whole thing up. Everyone died. Didn't everyone? All like the women died.
It's like 180-something. Although that is the same number I used also for the main. So it's a lot. Yeah. It is a lot, though. I think maybe 142, something in that area. It's 140 or so. The majority of people who died were women, and they were largely Italian and Jewish immigrants.
Immigrants.
Because those are two populations that tend to work at this point in history in textile production.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very young people were there. They were leaping to their death because they couldn't get out.
Yeah.
And they basically laid out the bodies on the street and waited for people to identify them. It was really awful.
It was really tragic. It was in New York City, by the way.
It was in New York. It's just off of Washington Square Park. So if any of you are going to New York with me in the next few weeks.
And me too.
Oh, Miss Knowles is going to see it. I'm going to take you to go see it. It's just off of Washington Square Park. You would never know it today. It's like a totally modern building. It's like, that's sort of weird, but actually I think it's still the same way facade harsh of the building, but it's anyway, I'll take you.
I'm so excited.
Yeah.
But yeah, so this is going to spark some reform, especially when we talk about workplace safety.
Mm-hmm.
You can't lock the emergency exits. There you go.
Yeah.
Fire escapes. We want to have things like that. Fire codes also start coming up around this.
Well, and it was also evidence of more corruption because the factory had just within the past few weeks passed a fire inspection.
Oh.
And that their fire escape was functional.
I did not know that.
Yeah. And so then they were like,
I'm sure all of these things were functional. So they were just locked.
About this fire escape not working. And then they start to see that the businesses are paying off the fire inspectors. And it's not a good sitch.
Not a good sitch
at all.
As
you kids say these days.
Do we?
I don't know. I'm very old.
I don't think I've heard that in a long time.
All right.
Sorry.
So when I think of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory, though, every time I walk out of Publix, I say, thank you, ladies, and a few men that died. Thank you. Because when you look, like when you leave Publix, they have little signs. Target has them. Everybody has them because you have to, that during business hours, these doors will remain unlocked. It's a direct result of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire.
There you go.
So there you go. Take that with us. All right.
Okay.
Oh, what was that? Is that W.B. Du Bois? Yeah, it is, but it's spelled wrong. There's no space between the U and the B. Way to go, Alan Brinkley.
There's also W space E space.
There's so many problems with this. Yeah, we didn't type this. I should correct that, though, and I will before you see it. Okay, yeah. So African-Americans and reform. Now that you guys are speed dating, some of you are now familiar with two men, actually three people, though, because it's two men and one woman.
Yes.
We have W.B. Du Bois. We see him there. And then we also have Booker T. Washington.
Riley McCormick and Breonna Leonard. Shout out to you.
Shout out.
W.E.B. and Booker T. Mortal enemies. Not mortal enemies. Kind of, though.
Kind of. W.B. Du Bois, Booker T. Washington, and Miss Ida B. Wells.
Ida B. Wells. A lovely lady. So,
man, she's tough. You know, Ida B. Wells was part of the, she wanted women to get the right to vote. And when she went to Alice Paul and was like, hey, this big march you're doing in Washington, D.C. for the women's right to vote, we want to be a part of it as African-American women. Mm-hmm. And Alice Paul's like, oh, man, this is tough because if I want people to buy into this women should vote, it's going to be easier just to get white women to vote.
Yeah.
And Ida B. Wells says, if we don't march with you, like on the front lines, because Alice wanted to put her in the back, then we walk against you.
Ooh.
What? God, I love that woman. Ida B. Wells.
Ida B. Wells. Tough broad.
Tough.
Love it.
She's got to be.
You know? Okay. So you want to talk about W.B. first or Booker T.?
I feel like Booker's always the best to start with.
I like starting with him too. So he, actually, W.E.B. Du Bois called him a compromiser. So they all wanted the same thing, which was equality, civil rights,
100%.
Political action regarding that. However, the way they went about it was quite different.
Right.
Booker T. was like, we're going to take it one step at a time.
Let's take it slow.
Let's do political. Let's do away with the barriers that we have to voting, because we have the 15th Amendment. We have universal male suffrage.
Yeah.
We just have literacy tests and poll taxes, if you remember that from period five, back when we talked about that. So let's get political equality. Let's be able to participate. And then let's do the next step. Let's get economic equality. Let's do that. And then we'll get to the social equality, and then we'll do that.
Yeah, it's kind of a thing that we'll even see later on in the 1950s with MLK Jr., that before he does his letters from a Birmingham jail, that you cannot legislate equality.
Right.
You cannot legislate changing the minds of people.
It's got to be.
And that's kind of where Booker T. is. Like, we got to take baby steps to make the big leaps.
Yeah.
All right.
He preached self-improvement.
Mm-hmm.
He founded, what's the school?
Tuskegee.
Tuskegee Institute, which was a vocational school. So we're going to work to get this level here. We're going to work to get the next level. And then once are snowballing kind of towards full social equality.
Yeah, and he advocated for what we sort of maybe view today, just because of where we are socially, he advocated for people to hold on to the jobs that you have, even if you view them as sort of retroactive.
Right.
Like if you're a black woman working as a domestic servant and people are like, so you have the same job effectively as you used to have, as your family, as your ancestors used to have. He said, but don't shun that, because education is not just academic. Education can be with your hands and many other things. So learn and then take a new step.
Yes.
But he had a big speech he gave at the Atlanta Exposition, which comes to be called the Atlanta Compromise, although he did not call it that.
No, he didn't.
In which he said that in all things, I don't know why I said sorry for you knocking over
your
phone.
Yeah, I almost talked right
on that one. That in all things, as far as like political process and economic process, we have to work together as a whole hand, but that in social progress, we can be as separate as the five fingers. And people took that as he advocated for segregation.
Yeah.
And it was just that one little key phrase, like, oh, he's a black man advocating for segregation. Yeah. But his point was, because we can't legislate that. Right. I mean, we can, but nobody's going to grab onto it.
We can. We have.
We have. But he saw it as more of a long, this is a marathon. This isn't going to be a sprint.
Right. Segregation is ultimately de facto and not truly like 100% de jure. And so we have to get everyone to embrace it within themselves.
Yes.
And only then
can right.
be true lasting equality.
Change the minds of men. Yeah. MWB was super like,
easy.
I'll change it.
Aggressively.
Aggressively. Right. So W.B. Du Bois is a Harvard educated. He's educated in history. He has a PhD in history.
Hey, got him. You're welcome.
Dang.
And
he is like, I'm sorry, Atlanta Compromise. Not going to happen. We will legislate. We will make changes. And we will force it upon
people.
And we'll
do it right now.
Yeah.
He was like, W.B., going to let you finish. Or Booker T., going to let you finish. But...
Right.
You're a compromiser.
Right.
Like, you're trying to compromise with the white man. You're not on the same page as everybody else. We're all ready for full, immediate equality, aggressive, manly agitation.
Yeah, and sort of a simplified comparison that we'll approach again in the 1950s and 60s is Martin Luther King Jr., mm-hmm. pre-letters from a Birmingham jail, mm-hmm. And Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. MLK is like, we'll get there. We'll do it. Let's hang yeah. out. Let's be buddies. And Malcolm X is like, no. Hold my latte. I got this. All right. Now, W.B. Du Bois is involved with an early movement towards equal rights that's called the Niagara Movement. That after we get the 15th Amendment, you got to change it up. And so they founded the NAACP, that is the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Mm-hmm. Now, he's part of this movement. Ida B. Wells is part of this movement.
I was just going to say Ida B. Wells. Wasn't she also a founder?
She was a founder of it.
Yeah. Ladies.
Love her. All right. So they're still around today, and they basically are advocates mm-hmm. politically, socially, economically for the advancement of African Americans.
African Americans. They're mm-hmm. still around.
Yeah.
Ida B. Wells, muckraker.
Oh, for sure.
So I wouldn't say that Booker T and W.E.B. were muckrakers, but Ida Wells was an anti-lynching
yeah.
advocate.
Yeah, she was a writer at a newspaper, and a few of her friends actually were lynched.
Yes.
And so she's like, so we should make that illegal.
In Alabama?
Yeah, somewhere yeah. in the South. But she was like, yeah, we should totally make lynching illegal.
Make murder mobs illegal.
Yeah. Well, simple enough.
Progressive.
Again, don't murder people.
Occur. Whatever.
All right. Well, I think we're good on this, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Temperance. Back to social order.
Let's do it.
So we've talked about temperance before. I think the last time was with the Whigs.
Back in time period four.
Yeah, you want people to stop drinking. We associated it, we blamed at the time immigrant communities like the Irish and the yeah. German, who sort of normalize public drinking. And
just like we had been doing since yeah. temperance started.
Yeah, and it hurts women. And yeah. it's typically women who kind of were the motivating force.
Yes.
No different mm-hmm. here.
Middle class women, once again, stepping yeah. your game up. So here we actually see a lot of success with the temperance movement in the prohibition phase of it. The WCTU, that's the Women's Christian Temperance Union, whoa. They are going to be the key group in bringing about federal level change the Constitution type of legislation. And yeah. it's going to be
Volstead Act. They passed the Volstead
Act and then the good old 18th Amendment after mm-hmm. that. Really securing the prohibition thing. A few people that are involved in the WCTU and in the prohibition movement, Carrie Nation, with her hatchet.
Carrie Hatchet Nation.
Hatchet Nation. That's who I was in the speed dating game that we played. No. I was Carrie Nation. She would straight up attack bars and restaurants with her little axe if they served alcohol.
Yeah.
She definitely did not like alcohol.
Yeah.
Vehemently against it.
Well, you know, she's trying to protect the ladies.
She's doing her thing, yeah.
Doing her best. So
much like we saw, like, just a quick kind of understanding of, like, the Volstead Act and the 18th Amendment. Oh, yeah. Volstead is V-O-L-S-T-E-A-D.
Volstead.
There is.
I've been spelling it wrong, but that's not a surprise. I've been spelling everything else wrong, too.
Yeah, it's just letters.
That's just who I am.
So the Volstead Act was the precursor to the 18th Amendment. So just like we had, like, the 15th Amendment, we had the Civil Rights Act of 1865 that became the 15th Amendment. They have to, like, modify it, change a couple things here and there, and then it gets passed as an amendment. So,
right.
Really, this sort of the same thing.
That's how you know when you're successful as, like, a social movement, is when you have an amendment to the Constitution. That is straight up success for you. And that's what every little grassroots movement and interest group is headed towards, is trying to get, like, you have to abide by this law, legislation passed. So, excuse me. So that, I mean, they were very successful.
Mm-hmm.
A few years later, though.
Gonna take that back.
We're gonna take that away.
Yeah, it turns out it's not gonna work out in the long run.
We go against it. We just straight up ignore it. Well, the president ignores it. He still serves alcohol at the White House.
He does.
Everyone's like, yeah, we're going to find quick routes around this 18th Amendment.
Sometimes deadly. So there's a lot of people, especially in urban spaces, are going to be poisoned by alcohol, because the government, for alcohol that's produced for more industrial purposes, which is already poison, it's not meant for consumption, by that I mean, they start adding like real poison, like skull and crossbones kind of poison to the alcohol, and they're like, people won't drink it now because it'll kill them. And then people just kept drinking it and dying. And then they're like, no problem, we'll add more. And so more people died. It's not a good situation. But also, the federal government's missing out on taxes for alcohol, and that's gonna be a big hit.
Yeah,
I want that money.
So I'm in the time frame that we bring back, or we undo prohibition of alcohol, is going to be Great Depression.
Yeah.
The government needs those taxes to have more government jobs.
Yeah.
Yep. So, there you go.
Yeah, I think that's good with the 18th. I don't think I have any other stories about that one.
I don't think so either.
I'm going to watch that poison show again, though. All right, so immigration restrictions. So the United States, I mean, if you hear temperance, then you know somebody's going to be blaming immigrants. Populations.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have to talk really, not too much on this, because it's really a continuation of a discussion we've already had with, like, nativism.
Right.
We've seen things like Chinese Exclusion Act. 1920s, we'll start getting quota acts.
Yeah, we'll keep talking. We're not going to talk too much about it now, because we've already talked about it at length. And we're going to keep talking about it at length.
Right.
But a few... So we've got the nativism piece that we've always had. Always.
Yeah.
The Irish, and then
the Know-Nothing Party. Remember them? The American Party?
Whew. The Know-Nothing Party. A classic.
Classic. Unfortunately, a classic.
Oh, Lord.
Well, okay. Good, a classic, because it's gone.
Yes.
But at least it's a classic. Is in like a at least it's a classic.
Not like
but man, it's a classic, unfortunately.
Unfortunately.
Okay. So one thing we need to introduce is, because we've gotten kind of into this, like, social Darwinist kind of mode, where we start saying, like, oh, we should use science to explain a lot of what's happening in the world around us socially. We see the development of eugenics, which is sort of social Darwinism in action, unfortunately.
In action, yeah.
And it effectively is that if you have a trait, whether it's your ethnicity or it's a disability or whatever, we will sterilize you so that you won't reproduce. That's not okay.
That's not
just highlighting
cool.
that for you
no.
all.
Yeah.
There are a lot of problems with it if you are thinking to yourself, like, wow, didn't the Nazis do that? Yeah.
Uh-huh. Sure did.
They sure did. So... this is a really problematic moment in American history that we will come back to. I like to talk about it with Charles Lindbergh, the aviation guy, the aviator.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll come back to that. But just know, it's not good.
It's not great.
No.
All right.
So another aspect of America that a lot of people are still pushing to change is the capitalist order, that the people at the very top are making profit off of causing poverty for others, is sort of the perspective. So Debs is still here.
Debs is still here. We're going to see this little rise in socialism and the Socialist Party. We talked about it last unit, where we were fighting the man. The man's keeping us down. And
we started back then, but we're going to really heat that up over here just because we do have a liberalization of society. So we're kind of getting a little bit more to the left. But extremely, we have Eugene Debs goes to jail, has some problems, goes to jail, and becomes a socialist and emerges from his hibernation as the not founder of the Socialist Party.
One of the leaders of it.
One of the leaders.
Yeah, so Socialist Party of America, the SPA, is founded in 1901 in the United States. Still around today.
Yes.
They still put up a person for president every year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're on there somewhere.
They're on the ballot.
Yeah. So we have the Socialist Party now completely founded, and we are going to see a pretty good numbers for, you know, a third party. It's not...
Right.
It's not great, but
right.
I mean, it's no populist party.
It's a third party. It's a third so party. So don't get us wrong, but it's, I mean, decent turnout for them.
Then we got the Wobblies.
The Wobblies, the industrial workers of the world. We're trying to take our small scale industrial, what am I thinking of? Unions.
Yeah.
Why can't I think of that?
I don't know.
Industrial unions, and we're going to take it. We're going to take it global.
Yeah. So founded by Big Bill Haywood.
Big Bill.
Big Bill from Montana. And Big Bill Haywood is going to bring the IWW all the way around the world.
Yeah.
We don't need craft unions and industrial unions. We need one union of workers versus the man.
The man.
It does not work out.
No. Definitely declines. They're aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
The Wobblies. They got, what am I thinking of?
I don't know. She's got a bad migraine, so...
I have a migraine, yeah.
She's having a hard time.
I'm having a hard time.
But that's all right. I can fill the space.
There you go.
So the Wobblies, particularly we get into the 19... teens? Late teens and into the 20s are going to get arrested a lot because they're protesting things like the war. And that's kind of a big no-no. We'll talk more about that later. But the Wobblies are going to decline pretty quickly, largely.
Decline was the word that I was looking for.
That stuck you up was decline.
The word decline.
Also could have used demise, which is also on the slide. But
can't read that far.
It starts to decline because, you know, people are all like, war, we got to get rid of radicals, and we're going to throw all these groups in there together.
Also, when we talk about World War One, we're going to talk about this more, but there's this thing called mobilization, and all of our factories need to be constantly pumping out guns and stuff for war, and we can't have strikes go on when we're trying to make things for war. So the labor movement, the labor union movement, like as a whole will decline, but especially Wobblies, because they're just like the loudest.
Well, they got a good name.
Wobblies. Yeah.
Ooh, Teddy.
Look at how cute he looks.
So many
of
you,
babe.
Many of you may know Teddy Roosevelt as, you know, president.
Right.
26th president. Thank you, Chandler Gazaway, for letting me know that.
Cool.
So he... Yep. And yes. Teddy Roosevelt, he's a New Yorker. Uh-huh. I mean, he's not just a New Yorker. Like, he is from NYC.
Right. Looking at Teddy Roosevelt and, like, looking at his accomplishments, you wouldn't be like,
Manhattan.
He's a city boy.
He's a city boy, that one.
But he is.
He is. He just adopted a lot of hobbies outside of the city.
Yeah, he's really into big game hunting.
Uh-huh.
The famous story with Teddy Roosevelt and the teddy bear. So the story goes that he was out hunting one day with his buddies, and they had killed a mother bear, and there was an injured cub that his friends chained to a tree, and were like, Teddy, shoot the bear, and Teddy's like, that's not an even trade here. Like, chaining an animal, actually, it's called bear baiting. Check it out. Oliver Cromwell made it illegal during the interregnum in England. Bear bait.
I'm so sad.
Basically, you can't tie a bear down and kill it. There's no game in that. Is basically
thank goodness.
Right. That's what Teddy's whole thing was. So Teddy's like, I'm not going to shoot the bear. Let the bear go. They actually did let it go. They did put it down, but humanely.
I don't know what that means in 1900, but
humane is.
They were electrocuting elephants at this point, so I'm not exactly sure what they meant
humane
by that.
Humane is a very loose term in the 1920s.
So, but they do, the bear cub does die, but the story sort of catches fire, and they start making
bears, stuffed bears, and calling them teddy bears.
Teddy Roosevelt, friend to animals. He killed it humanely.
I gotta Google that. How did this bear cub die?
I want to know, but I don't want to know because that's gonna make me really sad. Really
sad, yeah. So, government, capital, and labor. Teddy Roosevelt is very progressive.
Yes,
he is a member of the Republican Party. This is when the Republican Party is still primarily that party of reform. And we're starting to see some switches over, and it's really Teddy and Taft that we're going to see a big shift. It's not because of Teddy, though.
This point in time is very, so taking it back to my thesis paper on political parties, this is like a very convoluted Republicans and Democrats. There was like reform here, there's reform here. Different kinds of reform, but we're still doing it.
Right.
And then we have three parties, and then we have two parties, and then there's the socialists. And I'm like, what are we doing? It's just all big mess here, jumbled up. Mm-hmm. People getting stuck in bathtubs.
Wow, it's exciting. So Roosevelt's vision of federal power is basically this idea that we should have a relatively well, big government.
Yeah, he wants to grow
big government to help the people.
He's going to create some cabinet positions.
He will.
He's going to use his federal power to insert himself in business. Mm-hmm. He's a trust buster.
He is. He does have that moniker, trust buster, although he doesn't really break that many trusts, but he's the first president to do it very visibly.
Yeah, and he's like, this is an okay trust, this is a not okay trust.
Right, and the difference is that a bad trust is one that...
it's horizontally anything?
Well, it's ones that abuse the public.
Right. Oh, yeah.
If it abuses the public, then it's a bad trust. If it doesn't seem to hurt anybody or the market, let it do a thing.
Right. Okay. If it's fine. If there's, like, other businesses operating within the market, then it should be fine. But, yeah, he's – actually, there's a political cartoon that I show with teddy bears.
Yeah.
One's done. One's just in a trap so we can monitor it. And so that's, like, the good trust, bad trust. He has got Square Deal.
Yeah, that's coming up. Northern Securities Company, by the way, is one of those that he does break up. That's the big one that he breaks up. But there are going to be more. And basically, there's always the story with Teddy that somebody from the Northern Securities Company calls him and says, hey, listen, what can we do to stop you from doing this, from breaking us up? And he said, nothing. Hung up.
I like that.
Very aggressive. Nothing. There's a better story in what he actually said, but close enough for us.
No!
Okay, so the big thing with Teddy Roosevelt, again, is that he wants big government, meaning he wants agencies, he wants cabinet, he wants regulations to help the people.
Yeah, expands bureaucracy, expands the cabinet. Labor, he's the coal strike guy.
Yeah, he's a big supporter of the labor movement, but is that the next slide?
Maybe. All right. Good old Teddy and the Square Deal.
So this is part of his big government system.
Yes, that we just talked about. So... Square Deal is like we're trying to make things fair and square. We've heard that before. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be a lot to do with the consumer. So we're going to target business a lot. Mm-hmm. Good.
Well, and that's when we think about Teddy Roosevelt. I mean, he's a Republican. He is a reformer. This is when we still label that party as very much a reforming party.
Yeah.
And so he's like, yeah, I want to have, like, really big government, and that includes big military because, you know, he's a Navy guy.
Yes.
But it also is that the point of all of this big government is to help the people. And so that's really what he's trying to do. And the Square Deal has a number of components to it, not just Hepburn and Pure Food and Drug Act, but Pure Food and Drug Act is, like, the best part. And it all starts because of Upton Sinclair, which some of you now have met and dated briefly.
Dated briefly.
Perhaps
wrote Valentine's too.
You never know. So Upton Sinclair writes this book, The Jungle, and he writes it in order to expose the conditions of the Eastern European immigrants working inside the food industry, the food production industry.
Specifically the Chicago meatpacking industry.
Yeah, but it turns into something else because people are like, yeah, that's sad and poor conditions and all. Wait, we're eating what?
I'm sorry, pardon?
So there are entire parts of this book that are like, you're eating human meat.
Yes.
And rats. And you know, people spit.
Not
tuberculosis.
Good.
Oh, and that meat that goes back because it's green and smells bad, we just rub it with chemicals and the smell goes away
and
then you eat it anyways. And people were flipping out. This was like,
think about that that romaine lettuce recall.
Oh my god.
People are like, no, not my salad.
I was missing my Caesar salads.
I feel that.
It was rough.
But we've moved beyond it. But it's thankfully because of the Pure Food and Drug Act that we're able to kind of step in. So
yeah, the jungle is going to be considered fiction. Mm-hmm. But and people are like, oh, this is gross. Where is he getting this information? Like, maybe we should check this out. And so we're going to have the Meat Inspection Act. Mm-hmm. We're going to have the Pure Food and Drug Act. We're going to create the Food and Drug Administration. Because that's nasty. We can't have that.
And while he writes it as a fictional tale, it's from firsthand experience that he's getting this information. Yeah. And he actually went into some of these industries and started working to kind of get a feel for the conditions that they were in. So it is absolutely based on truth.
It is true.
Yeah, and that's why it really sparks this kind of panic.
Right. So yeah.
We'll talk to you in class about how you're eating human flesh.
Yeah.
It's super gross, but not anymore, kids. Now it's just pink slime, which is just part of the animal.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like a weird part with chemicals and stuff, but it's, you know, nose to tail. Right?
Right. Don't let anything go to waste.
Very good. All right. So Pure Food and Drug Act, just making sure, like, they start inspecting things. They start making sure that the labels are appropriate.
Right. Labels.
When you buy something, you know
what's in it. For. Yeah. And protecting consumers in that way.
Yeah. So good.
Did we say what the Hepburn Act
was? No, we did not say what the Hepburn Act. The Hepburn Act is going to continue to strengthen the ICC.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically all that is. Which is good.
Yeah, that's good.
Because that protects consumers, because it helps with pricing and rates and all of that. Mm-hmm. It also helps to stabilize smaller businesses and smaller companies. But the Hepburn Act just takes the Interstate Commerce Commission and really pumps it up, because it has what we say, no teeth. Basically, I can shake my finger at you, but I can't punish you, really. Now we can start to punish
people. There was a lot of things before this big time period where we were going to grow the government. There was a lot of rules. Mm-hmm. But there was no one to say, to go out and be like, you're not following the rules, change it, or we're going to punish you. And so that's what the Hepburn Act is doing, is kind of just the task force.
There we go.
All right. Next. Keeping it going.
What?
Yay, conservation. How nice. Just trying
John Muir.
To. John Muir. Someone was John Muir in here too.
Oh, yeah.
And Teddy Roosevelt.
Well, yeah.
They were part of the speed dating
act. Yes, they were. They were.
I have a lot of Valentine's written from John Muir to Teddy Roosevelt. Wow. And vice versa.
So we know Teddy is a big game hunter, right? He likes to hunt, but he loves America and its resources. And he realizes that if all those resources are depleted, where is he going to hunt?
Exactly.
Answer, Africa. More to come on that. but he meets this guy, John Muir, and Muir is like a scientist, kind of enthusiast. I got to double check that one. I just saw a show on him too, and I feel like he was doing photography out in these forests, but I think he actually was a trained scientist.
An enthusiast.
She's going to Google that. I feel like he's occupation is.
Known as John of the Mountains. I like that.
We're looking at a picture of him. He's looking at a pine tree.
Scottish-American naturalist, author, environmental philosopher.
Oh.
Glaciologist.
Yeah.
All right.
So he's glaciers. All right. So, yeah. But he is, I know that at one point in the show that I saw that he was like, hey, Teddy Roosevelt, how about you and I go out and start looking at stuff and taking pictures of stuff and we'll just hang out and do our thing. And that's exactly what they did. And they sort of went around to a bunch of what eventually would become national parks. Mm-hmm. And Teddy Roosevelt's like, you know what we need to do? We need to preserve, P-R-E, mm-hmm. A lot of this, which means that it won't be touched, and that's largely going to be our national parks that are established. And then we also need to conserve,
right.
C-O-N, which is, let's use it, but
later.
Watch how we use it.
Yeah, there's a difference between, I know in the past people have had a hard time distinguishing between preservation and conservation, but when you conserve something, you have to save it now. It's kind of like rationing a little bit. You got to save it now
so you can it, but
continue to use it for a very long time, whereas preserve, we're just not going to touch it.
Right. And so we have the foundation.
School's on a nature preserve right now.
It is.
So,
that's why you guys don't get parking.
Right. Sorry about that.
Sorry. But it's because of nature.
Right. You're welcome for the nature, by the way, and the oxygen that comes from the trees.
I have a plant in my room just for a little extra
oxygen.
So you know, John Muir is going to be important with co-founding the Sierra Club, which is all about preservation and looking at plants and trees and apparently glaciers, because he's a glaciologist.
Glaciologist.
And he is just a big proponent of he's an environmental advocate, we'll say, very early on.
Yes.
And Roosevelt is going to look towards providing more federal aid out west, trying to kind of bolster and protect a lot of the environment.
Growing the federal government by using federal funds to protect wilderness and things like that. So mm-hmm. once again, growing the size of the federal government. Got lots of national parks because of these two fellas.
Have you ever been to a national park?
I have been to Yellowstone.
Oh, Yellowstone. Mm-hmm. I've been to Florida parks.
Yeah, state parks.
I've been to state parks. That's about it. One of these days.
Isn't that forest that, you know, on I-10, that one forest?
Osceola.
Is it Osceola? Mm-hmm. I should know that.
Wow.
Rough.
Also, the, like, Itchitechny is a forest.
That's what I was thinking, too. Well, look at that. That's not national. Those are state.
It's state. Yeah. It's a state park. Anyways. Itchitechny. Just so you all know, Miss Knowles and I did actually at one point this summer talk about taking you on a field trip to the Itchitechny.
Yeah.
But it did not come to fruition.
Didn't pan out.
But we wanted to, guys.
All right. So Teddy Roosevelt serves and then exits office.
Yeah, but he only serves, he doesn't even serve two full terms.
Two full terms, no.
And so he only serves a portion of McKinley's term because mm-hmm. McKinley was assassinated. Mm-hmm. And then he serves his own term. And then he's like, well, that's two. Technically, at that point, he actually could have kept going.
Yes. Because it's elected for full terms.
Right.
And he was only elected one time.
Right.
He took over very shortly after McKinley began his second term.
Okay. So he at this point, TR is like, well, I'm good because I'm going to handpick the next Republican nominee, and that's going to be my best friend.
Yeah, boy.
And his name is William Howard Taft. There he is.
A mustache for the ages.
Oh, yeah.
Look at that thing.
And he is a lawyer. Mm-hmm. His dream job, his vision board that he makes at night is to be a justice on the Supreme Court. That's really what he wants. And Teddy's like, man, you're going to be amazing as president. You're going to be a reformer just like me. You're going to keep helping the little guy. This is going to be amazing.
Taft was like,
you're doing that.
Sure.
I'm going to go hunt some creatures over in Africa.
Yeah.
So I'm leaving America in good hands.
Some creatures.
Well, I was going to say buffalo, and I'm like, dang.
They're not there.
Elephants, tigers, bears.
No tigers in Africa either.
Dang it.
We're having a rough day, guys. So Taft was like, yeah.
Yeah,
sure,
got
sure.
It.
Got it.
That's
I'll
what
be
I
president.
Want. I want to be a reformer just like you.
Psych.
And that did not work out. So the first is the Payne-Aldrich tariff. So one of the things that was a really big deal for the Republicans at this point is that many of the Republicans wanted to lower tariffs. Because lower tariffs mean more options for Americans. Mm-hmm. It means less pricing. Less pricing.
Competitive
increase.
Pricing.
Yeah. And so it really does help the little guy, which remember is the whole point of what TR was doing.
Right.
And so this bill comes up, the Payne-Aldrich tariff, which on the surface looks like it's supposed to do just that, lower taxes. Mm-hmm. But it turns out there's a ton sort of tacked on to this that, well, like on the main part of the bill, like we'll lower some tariffs. On the rest of it, it's like, oh, we're going to tax the heck out of all this other stuff. And essentially, while it should have been a reform bill, when Taft was approached by sort of the what we would call the old guard of the GOP, like the old timers, the ones that have been there for a long time, mm-hmm. the business ones, the pro-business guys, those guys are like, Taft, you got to raise tariffs. You got to help us out. We need to make a buck. Mm-hmm. And Taft is like, okay. So this seems like not a big deal, but the Payne-Aldrich tariff is something that makes the Republican Party no longer a party of reform. So from this point out, Taft no longer is viewed as a reformer. He is not the Republican Party is not viewed as a reform party. And this is going to cause a bit of a friendship strain.
A little bit of a friendship strain.
Yeah. Because Teddy's like, wait, what happened? And then something else happens, which I know you want to talk about.
Which is the Ballinger-Pinchot dispute. I always call it the Pinchot-Ballinger. No,
maybe I just always did call it Ballinger-Pinchot.
Wow. So this is where it ends, Collazo.
Do you even history?
Wow. So it is Gifford Pinchot and Ballinger's first
Richard
name
Ballinger.
Is Richard.
I like Gifford Pinchot, and I remember that because no one's named Gifford. True. So Ballinger is going to be the Secretary of the Interior for the United States, and Pinchot is going to work under him. So they're
in the Forest Department, right?
Yeah, he's the head of the Forest Service.
And he was like handpicked by Teddy, yeah. A la the Wisconsin idea.
Yeah, Teddy was like, I like conservation. Conservation's my thing. I like Gifford Pinchot. Gifford Pinchot is going to be in charge of my Forest Service. So Pinchot was very important.
And he was a scientist.
He knew what he was talking about.
He was
about.
A forestologist.
A forestologist. My. I did not know that was a thing.
I made it up, but you get my point, guys. He's a guy who studies forest and trees and arborist.
It's just called a forester. He was an American forester.
Fine.
So anyway, in charge of the head of the Forest Service. So... Ballinger, some land in Alaska, I believe, was being disputed. Mm. The way it was handled, I think he gave, it wasn't bribery per se.
But he started selling it off.
But he started, like, selling it for inappropriate reasons to people. And...
Yeah, basically the land, which was supposed to be, like, under conservation rules,
right?
If people came, companies came in and they're like, hey, but can I use it to extract oil? He'd be like, I don't know, how much you want to pay me? And then he started selling it off.
Sure, you can do it. It's going to cost you.
Yeah.
And so as this went on, it was being investigated by just officials in the department, investigators in the Department of Interior. And Glavis, someone whose last name is Glavis, went to Gifford Pinchot and was like, this land that's supposed to be conserved, Ballinger, the Secretary of the Interior, which is a very important position, it's more important than head of Forest Service in the grand scheme of things, is basically selling off land that's supposed to be conserved to the highest bidder. And so Gifford Pinchot was like, not on my watch, goes to William Howard Taft and is like, this is happening, your boy... Ballinger, that you appointed Secretary of Interior, is doing this, and that's wrong, that's inappropriate. And President Taft was like, these are groundless claims, there's no proof. And Glavis was like, here you go, here's the receipts that I have for you. So he didn't believe that, fired Glavis, the guy that investigated. And then Gifford Pinchot was like, oh, I'm going to tell everybody, and leaked all of this information about how Taft was trying to protect the Secretary of Interior. Why is he doing that? This is super sketchy. And then that's that. And Pinchot was obviously going to be fired too.
Right.
Because of that.
But the reason that, I mean, this just obviously goes back to this idea that he's really not trying to help the right. little guy.
He's
in this
trying
case,
to
like,
put some money in his
he's
pocket.
He's trying, yeah. Word gets over to Africa and TR hears about it and he's like, shut the door. Taft, I'm coming for you.
Right.
The friendship. Temporary hiatus. It's actually going to, they don't talk for quite some time. Mm-hmm. They'll get back together, so don't worry too much
don't
about
worry
that.
Don't worry about their friendship. It's fine.
And you know that that Taft was having a hard time because he started to eat his emotions. So many emotions.
Lots of emotions.
He weighed like 600 pounds.
Oh my gosh.
That's really? A lie. I don't know how much he weighed, but.
Stop lying to me about facts that I believe.
But he was big enough to get stuck in a bathtub. True story. He did. I don't know the logistics of getting him out of the bathtub, or do you like?
You gotta put some baby oil in there.
Baby oil, butter him up. I mean, who had to help? Anyways, there's no
anyway.
Bigger bathtub in the White House because of this.
Yes.
For
so
any big bone presidents that want to get on in there.
So TR got fired up, comes back to the States, and is like, "I'm taking over from here. You're not gonna be. You're not representing the Republican Party accurately." I'm stepping in.
I'm coming in.
And Taft was like, yeah, but I'm going to run for re-election.
Yeah. Not that he wanted to, but the party's going to be like,
you've got to do it again.
What kind of party doesn't allow their incumbent president
right.
to keep running?
Right. So
Roosevelt Teddy comes back.
Teddy Roosevelt's like, well, in that case, I'm going to start my own party.
Yep.
And it's going to be specifically labeled the Progressive Party because that's who I am, a progressive. Mm-hmm. Me, Teddy Roosevelt.
Okay.
But obviously, we're going to nickname it the Bull Moose Party.
Right.
Because that's just because
he's as strong and as stubborn as a bull moose.
The bull moose.
So there
you
go.
He's coming for you.
New nationalism is this idea of the big federal government in order to support the people.
It's the square deal reinvented.
Yeah. It's just another name.
We're coming back.
Arose by any other name would still be new nationalism.
New party, new domestic policy plan. It's the same.
Perfect.
Oh, Wilson.
But with the Republican Party split, the vote split between Taft and Lincoln,
yeah,
it allows for the Democrats to win this one.
And listen.
And thus we have Woodrow Wilson.
The Republican as a reform party was very, very popular for a very long time. And so when Taft was clearly going to be the conservative population, then the Progressive Party is going to be a reform party. We also have the Socialist Party, which is considered a reform party. Eugene Debs, shout out. And now the Democrats. Wilson's like, man, that was so popular, this whole reform thing. I'm just going to do it.
I'll just do it. And he's got the bigger party base because the other side of the aisle is all split in different directions. So he's like, I'm going to trick him by saying it's still the Democrats. And I'm just going to run also as a progressive.
Right. So, Woodrow Wilson and the New Freedom. New Freedom is, it's basically just going to turn into TR's new nationalism. Yeah. So, his idea was, I think what we'll do is we'll have small government that helps the people. That doesn't actually work out.
No.
And about a year in, he has to be like, okay, I'm just getting big government, Let's make it as big as we can.
I just lied about this.
I thought that would work out differently.
All right, you called my bluff.
All right, we're a big guy. So, he gets the title scholar as president because he actually is president of Princeton for some time.
He's a smart cookie.
He's a smart cookie, yeah. He does look like Nosferatu a little bit, but there he is. What? Dracula, the original vampire. Stop it, look it up. So, okay. Lowering the tariff, nailed it. Done.
Check. What's next?
Federal Reserve Act, did it.
Check. Also, check.
Before I tell you what these things are.
Huh?
I should tell them what these are.
Underwood tariff lowered the tariff.
There we go.
We're taking the Payne-Aldrich tariff. That was allegedly going to lower the tariff. It didn't. And we're changing it up to the Underwood tariff that's actually going to lower tariffs. So competitive pricing, better prices for the consumer, demand, supply, whole nine yards. Check. Federal Reserve Act, speaking of money.
Makes the Federal Reserve.
It's like the permanent bus.
Yeah, I kind of tried to explain the Federal Reserve as it's a bank for banks.
Yes.
So, like, you can't go there and cash a check. But Wells Fargo, Bank of America, they're all regulated by
the Fed. The Fed determines interest rates. Mm-hmm. The Fed determines share rates, things like that. More stuff. If you come to economics next year, it'll talk all about the Fed.
There you go. Still around today.
Still around the Fed.
The Fed. Still around today. We actually have a branch here in Jacksonville.
We sure do.
We do. And if you go in there, you can see a cart full of money that's like a $10 million money cart. And I was like, well, why would you just leave it there? And they're like, well, you can't take it. And I was like, so why is it just here?
What's stopping me from
What's the point? You're just showing off? I get it. You got money. Okay.
They're just trying to flex on you.
Yeah. So Federal Reserve is going to stay around even modern times.
Forever.
Retreat and events. So we start with some child labor laws. This is called the Keating-Owen Act. It's Keating-Owen.
Mm-hmm.
And the Keating-Owen Act says you cannot trade products that were created by child labor across state lines because guess what? We get to regulate.
Interstate commerce.
And those companies were like, yeah, that's fine. We'll just do it inside our state. Not a big deal.
Yeah, so, no problem here.
So they try to start moving towards that.
Yeah.
And it ultimately fails. But at least now we're getting some federal movement on it.
Exactly. That's all we needed was federal movement on child labor.
Yeah. So I'm pretty sure this is it.
All right. So
more to come in class, though, because I do like to compare and contrast my federal or my progressive presidents.
I do like to put up my little T-charts and do that, so.
But I'm going to leave you with a, before we play out here, I'm going to leave you with a question I want you all to think about, which is, how did Teddy Roosevelt use Hamiltonian means to achieve Jeffersonian ends?
All right.
Good luck with that one. We'll talk about it in class.
We'll talk about it later.
All right,
so this was
a long one.
This was a decent sized one,
but it's got a lot of info in it, so.
All right. We'll see you later.